Ah, hello, my friends, and welcome to the Basement Sublet of Horror. And tonight, well, this is a bit of a redo. I've already shown this film, but to tell you the truth, I had to snip it down. I didn't really quite show the whole thing. So tonight, it's the complete version of a rare film. As a matter of fact, this film's never been released. It's The Beast from the Beginning of Time, shot in 1965 with the director Tom Leahy. And Tom Leahy was actually a horror host. And by the way, one of the early ones, one of the original ones from the 50s. His show, The Host and Rodney, played in Wichita, Kansas from the 50s on and off till the 90s. Yeah, quite a show. Tom Leahy was quite a fun actor, too. Well, anyway, this movie is an all-star cast of Wichita performers. There's Dick Welsbacher, who was a theater professor at Wichita State University and a local actor. There was Webb Smith, who is a local newscaster on Channel 3. By the way, Channel 3 also sponsored this film. And also there's Henry Harvey, who I'll get into later, who was another movie host in Wichita. So, well, off we go. Here it is, the complete version of The Beast from the Beginning of Time.
Maury, Professor Maury, come quickly.
What the deuce do you want, man? Can't you see I'm busy?
I know you are, Maury. I wouldn't interrupt you if I didn't think it was important.
Well, all right, man, out with it. What is it?
Maury, the workmen have found something.
Remarkable. The workmen have found something. That's remarkable. Now, what the devil do you think we're here for except to find something?
No, no, this is something you have to see, Maury.
Oh, all right.
There it is, Maury. It's a hand. A human hand.
Well, hand me that trowel.
No, that's all right. It can break away.
Yeah, the rock just seems to fall away from it. That's the way they found it. Didn't you, Pablo? He just stepped up here on the promontory and the rock fell away. Just popped off like a peanut shell. Say, isn't this the same strata that we took the reptile fossil from?
Oh, good Lord, you've been here. You're a geologist, don't you know, man?
Of course. I'm just a little excited, Maury, that's all.
Maury, do you suppose the whole body's here? How could it be? How could anyone bury a body in this rock? And Maury, this must be a...
Oh, will you shut up? Henderson.
Yeah.
Get them to work removing this thing here, and be sure they get plenty of rock with it. Here.
Vamanos, muchacho.
Tell them to start right here, you understand? Take it easy.
No.
What's the matter with them? They're scared. They think it's a devil. Un diablo.
Those stupid, idiotic pigs. Well, tell them it's a very dead devil, and it can't hurt them.
El Diablo Muerte. Alan, pronto.
Pronto.
Come on.
Come on.
Thank you. you going to be at the site, John?
Oh, no more than a few days. Maury called last night and said they expected to finish up the excavation work sometime today.
Oh, did it go well?
Well, evidently quite well. Maury seemed very excited. They extracted some beautiful specimens, remarkably well-preserved fossils, especially the Cretaceous. But he thought I should be there for the wind-up of things. Fine field and research man, but he's woefully disinterested in the humdrum. You know, crating, stenciling, cataloging, and the like.
Probably gives him an excuse not to bathe. Not that I've ever noticed he needed an excuse to avoid that civilized ritual.
Now, Ford, he's a dedicated man. Brilliant talents, enormous energy.
I wish he'd channel some of those energies into his relationship with his fellow man.
Ah, I suspect you've received the Maury treatment, too.
Two? Continually. Why, confound it, I've met the fellow a dozen times and have had to introduce myself to him every blasted time. Now, I ask you, John, is Barston such an easily forgotten name?
Well, I can't say for the Barston name, but certainly not the Barston physique.
Hmm? What do you mean by that?
Nothing at all, Ford. Have another drink.
I haven't finished this one yet.
Fine. You were saying?
Yes, Maury. Why, do you know that when I speak to him, pleasantly, mind you, the fellow just grunts and looks away. He won't even look at me.
Well, diplomacy certainly isn't his long suit. That's true.
No, I should think not. Lord knows I've had enough experience dealing with you scientific ducks to endure all varieties of abnormal behavior. But this is the first one I've encountered that seems to have the lack of power of speech. Some of you have difficulty communicating, all right, but most of you can muster a hello or a goodbye. Not necessarily at the appropriate time, I might add.
Now who's being facetious?
Well, I only hope some of his bad manners haven't rubbed off on young, what's-his-name, you know, the fellow that's with him.
Randall. Creighton Randall.
Yes, Randall, that's it. Now, there's a young man that impressed me. Very bright, very pleasant chap.
He's very personable, and he can learn a lot from Maury, especially in the field.
I just can't see how you place all that faith in him, John. Confound it, I like a man who can look me dead in the eye. You can tell what sort of a fellow that type of man is, but this furtive, shifty acting type... Is...
And that, Mr. Barston, is why you retain me. I do it, then you don't have to. Oh, come on, Ford, don't sit there smoldering. As soon as we get back, I'll start Professor Maury on a crash refresher program on the handling and ego-nourishing of the museum's board of directors. Specifically, its chairman, one Ford R. Barston III. Or is it the fourth?
Now, confound it, John, now you're making me seem pompous.
Ford, you are pompous.
I pompous? Well, by Gadfrey, I don't know if I appreciate that. I've never felt that I was overly impressed with my importance. In fact, if anything, I feel...
Are we interrupting anything?
Yes, thank heaven. Ford was about to soar into a discourse on one of his many virtues, I think.
At least I ask you, how do you tolerate this fellow?
I have no choice, Mr. Barston. That's the curse of being a younger sister. I try to bear the stigma as gracefully as possible.
Well, I'm glad to see that at last there's someone in the world besides me who can see behind the mask of respectability the scoundrel wears. Good for you, Elise.
Assassins, you're both assassins. Ford, have you met my assistant, Paul Benson?
I met Mr. Barston at the Marshall Foundation tea. It's good to see you again, sir.
Oh, yes, of course. Good to see you,
Benson.
I know his name, confounder. Yes, good to see you again, Benson. Real pleasure.
Everything ready to go, Elise.
As you commanded, sire. Bags packed. Here's a plane ticket. And the car outside to take you to the airport.
You're a very efficient young lady, Elise. Very efficient. It's a good thing you are, because what are you all staring at me for?
Why, you were telling me you were the expert on the vagaries of behavior of scientific ducks like me. Don't you know? We're ready to go.
Well, I haven't finished my drink yet.
Generosity is my finest virtue, Ford. You may take it with you.
You see what I mean, Elise?
I do. He's incorrigible.
Ford...
Oh, all right, but I won't take your blasted drink with me.
Good. It's high in calories anyway. Let's see if I have everything. Papers in the briefcase. Airplane tickets in my pocket.
Luggage in the car. Come on. The plane leaves at 2:30 and it's 2 right now.
Oh, all right. Just a minute.
Well, confound it. You rushed me through my drink and now you aren't even sure you're ready.
Come on, brother dear. You have everything.
All right, all right.
Oh, Benson. Say, if you get the opportunity down there, see if you could arrange to have this abomination of a museum director deposited in some nice deep hole, will you? He needs it.
be careful, you idiots. Don't drop that. I don't want that park to fall off. Easy. Don't drop it, you idiots. Easy. All right, Henderson, get him out of here.
Okay, hombre. He's bombing us.
Henderson.
Yeah.
Take him back to town and pay him off.
What about the crating and the loading?
Look, you just do as you're told. Now, Randall and I will take care of the crating. You just get your truck back here the day after tomorrow morning. You understand?
You're the boss.
What are you waiting for?
Is that thing a man?
Yes. Yes, it seems to be some sort of a primitive man. It's nothing out of the ordinary, though. You know, mummies are being excavated from this part of the Southwest every day from Indian burial mounds. You know that.
Yeah.
Well?
I'll be back the day after tomorrow morning, as early as possible.
Hola.
They're leaving.
Good.
Why'd you let them go, Maury?
Why not? Well, I mean, all the work we've got left, the inventory, the crating.
You afraid you're going to have to do your share of the work now?
Hardly fair.
Well, Crawford and Benson will be here at the site anyway. The four of us can certainly handle it. Look, we can't know the full significance of this yet, but I don't want to run the risk of those workmen babbling about it in town. You heard them. Un diablo, a devil. Those superstitious fools.
Does it really matter if they do?
Are you questioning my decision?
No.
Then do me a favor and shut up.
Oh, I'm sorry. What time are we to meet their plane?
My watch has stopped. What time do you have?
It's 4:15.
Well, I better go then. The plane's due at 5:30.
Don't you want me to go too?
Well, of course not. We can't leave this thing unguarded. You'd better stay here.
Oh, you're right. Maury, won't Crawford be elated when he sees our discovery?
Yes, I'm sure he will. But while I'm gone, Randall, why don't you see if you can remove some more of this rock? It doesn't seem to be adhering to the flesh. Shouldn't be too difficult. Here. Like this. You got a bit of light.
Yeah, I'll take care of it.
Good. Well, I'd better go.
Yes, you'd better. I'll see y'all later.
The film was financed by Wichita TV station Channel 3 for $10,000. And, well, why did they do that? Well, they wanted to get into the made-for-TV market. And why did they pick horror, you say? Well, they picked horror because at the time, the highest-rated shows on TV were creature features, oddly enough. We return now to the basement sublet of horror. Most of the scenes in this film, and the interiors especially, were shot at the Channel 3 studios. They were shot after the station closed down for the night, and they worked all night till 5 in the morning every night for 10 weeks to complete the picture. I bet doing that double duty for the people who worked on it was quite grueling at the time.
How many of you remember this from way back when? Well, an awful lot of us did back in 58 and 59 and again in 69 to 71 when Tom Leahy used to introduce the old Nightmare Show. Only we didn't appreciate what a new thing we were watching. Vampira had been a costumed hostess all by herself in L.A. starting in 54. And Roland had become successful in Philadelphia and then famous as Zachary in New York, hosting and co-writing, and had an off-screen co-star. But Wichita's Tom Leahy was the first one who did it all, hosting and writing original scripts unrelated to the evening's movies, designing and painting the set, and creating the makeup design for both himself and his on-screen co-star Rodney, all without the benefit of ever having seen another host.
John Froom. John Froom came up with it. They had bought the old shock package, which came out at that time, and John came to me and asked, did I want to do it? Because he knew I was kind of way out at that time anyway, a fired sort of cat, and asked me if I wanted to do it. I said, sure, I'd be glad to do it. And then we talked it and kicked it around and thought about a Laurel and Hardy concept. You know, I have a foil, a goony guy, and Lee Parsons was a stagehand at Cake at that time, and John thought of the name Rodney. And so he asked Lee. Lee was really excited about doing it, so we had a pretty good meld there, you know, and it went real well for about 2.5 years. When was it? I'd say 1954, 55 maybe. I don't know, really, honestly. It was way back there, 30 years ago at least. Well, yeah, we parodied modern society as much as anything, you know, much like the Addams Family in that the abnormal was the normal, you know, that sort of thing. But no, we didn't do anything about the films. The makeup and costumes I designed. John, the original set was designed by John and, you know, the stage crew there that built the thing. But I did the makeup and conceived of the makeup. Rodney took about 30 minutes, and mine about 32. The original Cake Nightmare, Bill Sykes, who is now program director at KSN, he and I worked together on the thing. Really, more or less, you know, we kicked it around is what we did. That was from the old shock package. They had that in the on the brochure that came, you know, and so we just had shot it, made photographs of it, and then burned it. Primitive, huh? You know, now you wouldn't do it this way. I think they sprayed lighter fluid on the back of the picture, lit it, and moved away from it, yeah. Just about one dry run is what we'd do. Mm-hmm. Because in those days, no videotape. You know, so whatever we did, that was it, and it went out. And just about one dry run, but we did very well, because we had a lot of visual effects that carried out. We didn't have chroma key in those days. So if you were going to, I know one instance we had where I had little nephew Claude come to visit, and little nephew Claude was supposed to be about 7 or 8 years old, and little nephew Claude was about 15 feet tall. He was a giant, I don't know if you recall it. So what we had to do, keep little nephew Claude on one side of the set, but we miniaturized that whole section of the set, and you know, and in proportion, and then blacked that part of the screen out, supered that in there where he played while we played in our section over here, in order to get the giantism. We got letters all the time, fan letters and things like that, but, and we had some pictures done, you know, handouts, and I answer the letter and usually enclose a picture. But not as such. You don't understand, it was kind of like a throwaway thing. It filled a void on the programming from 10:30 to midnight or midnight to 1:30 or whatever they wanted to do. It was never what I call a premiere type presentation of that station, because that was about the beginning of the news wars, you know, and that's where all their interest was trying to get number one news here in the market. And no, we had seen none, because it was just getting off the ground. They tailored it around that shock package that played all over the United States. So I think it was about the same time. They would almost be together, I would think. I think it was down in Philadelphia or something that was doing this story. Yeah, but I know, no, I've never seen it. I don't know of any except the gal in L.A., you know.
Elvira.
Didn't she come from Wichita? Lived here one time or something like that. And that's, she does it for a campy thing. You know, it's kind of cute, what I've seen of it. We had two firecracker stands, Lee and I did, and we got in that makeup every night and raced from one stand to the other to make personal appearances. But the worst personal appearance I ever had was some skating rink. We went to a skating rink down south here someplace, and they wanted us on skates. Well, me on skates is next to a disaster. Oh, it was awful. And, you know, it was just terrible. Thank God it was only for an hour. Now, we had my girlfriend, my intended, Cynthia, We said nothing but blood and fell over in our mashed potatoes when we constantly when we had a banquet. We had baby doll Glutkin, who was, we had Agnes the Abominable Showgirl. We had, Internal Revenue Man, Infernal Residue Man was Lamont P. Treadwell, who we disposed of nicely. Okay, well, John Froom thought of the Laurel and Hardy concept of the thing. And of course, we had to put it in within the genre that we were. So the foil, my foil, had to be grotesque looking. And the Hardy character with me, who was always thought he was right, but was always wrong inevitably. And also the other guy, it was the poor simple thing, always came out ahead in the long run. And that's the premise we had, but then we put it within the framework of the horror type film. The Wolfman, I think, Lon Chaney Jr. The most horrible miscasting in the world. You know, really, honestly, here's Claude Rains, this sophisticated Englishman who's supposed to be his father, talking about Lawrence Talbot, you know. And here's this clutch, you know, hi, Dad. Man, it was ridiculous. And we look back on it now, Jeff, the makeup on that Grady looked like a O-Cedar mop with eyes, you know. I mean, that was about as much like a wolf when you compare it to, oh, The Howling and what was the other one? The real great, oh, Werewolf and American Werewolf in London. Yeah, gosh, not even the same category, is it?
Dr. Crawford, Benson, over here.
Bernie, it's good to see you.
I'm sorry our plane was late. Did we keep you waiting long?
No, not at all. Good to see you, Doctor. Benson,
Bernie? Say, this Texas sun must really agree with you. You're as brown as a berry.
Yes, well, there you are. Oh, I got you a motel on the edge of town. There's a good restaurant there, as good as any in town.
Well, I thought we were going to stay at the site, Bernie.
Well, you could, but well, we've been roughing it pretty much recently. You know, small tent, a couple of cots, and it'll be dark before long. Oh, I thought maybe after your long trip, you'd like a little more comfort than our camp affords. I can pick you up first thing in the morning.
Well, perhaps you're right. Randall stay at the site?
Yes, he thought it'd be best.
Guarding the treasures, huh?
Yes, you might say that. I think you're going to be very impressed with the specimen, Doctor.
Well, I'm sure I will, Bernie, but I must confess I was looking forward to seeing them this evening.
Well, you forced me to admit something, Doctor. You know me. I've kept myself and Randall so busy with the excavating that I'm afraid the details, the cataloging, is pretty much of a mess. Matter of fact, that's why Randall stayed, to try to get some order into it. I know, Doctor. You've told me before. Detail work certainly isn't my strong point.
True enough, Bernie, but you know that makes no difference to us.
Please, Doctor, indulge me in this. I desperately want you both to be impressed. Well, I have to admit, a good meal and a night's sleep sound just fine to me. Let's go pick up the luggage.
Back. Where are Benson and Crawford?
They decided to stay in town. Tired, I guess. I'll pick them up in the morning. You've made good progress.
Yes, you were right. The shale literally falls away from it. Well, that's odd. I would have thought Crawford would have been hard to restrain after you told him about finding the body.
Oh. Oh, you got any coffee made? I haven't eaten yet.
On the camp stove.
You did tell him, didn't you?
No.
For God's sake, why not? I wanted to surprise him. I wanted him to see the body after we had it completely extricated. And we'd better get at it if we're going to get it done.
What are you staring at me for?
Nothing, Maury. Nothing at all. I just can't figure you out. I would have been bursting to tell Crawford about our discovery if I were you.
Fortunately for me, you're not. Now let's get to work.
Thank you.
figure, Bernie? How old?
Well, it's hard to say exactly. The scintillometer tells us that according to the carbon atom deterioration, his age is in excess of several million years. Now, couple that with the strata in which we found him, and I'd say, 60 million years.
60 million? Fantastic. But how? Did that charred bit of flesh we took from the scalp been burned at a later date?
Through 12 feet of shale?
Then he must be that old, Marty. I checked the scintillometer only yesterday, and it's working perfectly. Imagine a man, a perfect Neanderthal type, living right in the middle of the reptilian age. Well, you know what this means? This fellow knocks every accepted evolutionary theory into a cocked hat.
I'm well aware of it.
But what could have preserved a body like this? The hair, the sinew. Look, there's even whisker stubble on the chin.
Chemicals in the shale, I'd imagine.
What about this laceration on the skull cap?
Well, I thought at first he must have struck his head, or been struck on the head. But that charred flesh around the wound would seem to indicate otherwise. And notice the constriction of the muscles in the extremities, as though he'd sustained some severe electrical shock. Now, this is only a guess, but it could be that he was caught out in some primordial thunderstorm and was struck by a bolt of lightning, right here on the top of his head.
Electrocuted? That must be it, Murray. He was electrocuted, and somehow, only God knows, the body remained preserved. Now, judging from the shell crayfish that we took from the rock, he must have fallen into a swamp, and the body remained intact. Perfectly intact. Well, we spent a good part of the night at 2:15.
Yes, we'd better get some sleep. I promised Crawford we'd pick him up early this morning.
You know, I can hardly wait for Dr. Crawford's reaction when he sees our reptile man.
He's not going to see him.
What do you mean, he's not going to see him?
Exactly that. We're not going to tell him we've found it.
Why, Murray, why?
Good Lord, man, don't you grasp the significance of this? That corpse is going to revise all scientific thinking as to man's first hour on the evolutionary timetable. Darwin be damned, Randall. This is going to be the new anthropology.
Oh, of course I get the significance of it, Murray, but why keep it a secret?
You're a naive fool, Randall. This thing's importance demands more than it's gathering dust in some dark museum alcove. It's worth a fortune.
How?
Exhibit it.
Exhibit it? Like a carnival freak? The Javanese merman and a bottle of alcohol, the two-headed boy? Is that what you want? We're scientists, Maury, not cheap con men. Besides, it's not ours to do with what we want.
We found it, didn't we? We broke our backs these months in that abominable heat. We've earned it, Randall.
Well, you can count me out. I want no part of it.
What are you going to do?
Well, I'm not going to tell Dr. Crawford about this conversation. But I am going to tell him that we found it.
No, you're not, Randall.
I'm not. Listen. I've put up with you these months because you're the head of this expedition, but not any longer. I'm sick of your tin god tactics, Maury. I'm fed up right to here. You're not roping me into this insane plot, and you're not telling me what to do.
I think you will, Randall. You see, I know about that incident in California, the affair with the Morrison girl.
How did you find out?
Oh, I make it my business to find out as much as possible about the museum personnel.
Well, go ahead and tell Dr. Crawford if you want to. I don't think he'd let it jeopardize my position now.
Oh, of course not. Not dear understanding Dr. Crawford. But I doubt if the board of directors would be as understanding of your indiscretion, shall we call it, if they were to find out. Museum reputation, you know.
All right, Murray. Have it your own way.
Don't worry, Randall. I've got it all planned out. Now, we crate up the body before I pick up Crawford. We fake it as tools or something on the inventory list. Now, I know Crawford. He'll be so engrossed in his fossils that he won't pay any attention at all. Then, when we get back to Farnfield, we make sure that we drop it off at the warehouse unopened.
Then what?
Then, a little later, you and I take a field trip on our own. And that's when we discover it. No museum affiliations, all on our own.
I don't know.
It'll work, Randall. And you and I are going to make the greatest scientific discovery in history. Just the two of us.
Wrong there, Professor.
There's going to be three of us.
Well, I guess that's everything except for the body and the specimen.
Well, I'd better be going. Henderson, help Randall crate up the body, will you? Unless that runs contrary to your newly acquired status.
Well, I'm just along for the ride. You can call the shots.
You sure you label that crate tool?
I will.
Walk to the car with me.
Looks like rain filling up up there.
Well, be sure you've got the tarp on tight.
Look, you have a gun.
What in the world for? Here. Take this. Henderson's up to something. He's been acting too cooperatively. You know, the stakes are too high in this for him to be botched up by him. So take this and put it in your shirt and use it if you have to. Go ahead, take it. Put it in your shirt. It won't burn you. Be sure you get that body crated up. Are you listening to me?
Yes, yes, I heard.
All right, I'll be back by noon.
What's so amusing?
I just wondered if you was planning on using it.
What in the world are you talking about?
That gun Mari gave you.
I
yeah, the way that devil-dealing rat had figured it.
You're hardly the person to be calling him names.
Why not? You see, Randall, the only difference between you and me is I don't pretend to be nothing but what I am.
You guys put up the front. Big brains. Still, here inside, you ain't one bit better than me.
Ah, you're right. We're all rotten. Yeah, that's where I got you, Randall. You got conscience. He's gonna dog you all through this business.
Will you shut up?
Randall, if you and me was real smart, we'd crate that thing up right now and get out of here.
Before Martin ever get back. In this rain.
Okay, a little that long. Why, this time of year, these gully washers go out just as fast as they come in. They'll
be gone in another quarter hour.
That ring on you. Why shouldn't we cut that weasel out?
Well, he's gonna stay down.
With a lead pipe cinch, he ain't. He likes his skin too much to do that.
No, think of this mess. Now listen, Maury told me to use it if I have to. So don't push me, Henderson. By heaven, I will use it if you give me any trouble.
You would? I believe you would. You're that scared.
Yes, I'm scared. And I'll use it if I have to. Now come on, get in that tent and let's get that corpse crated.
Oh, we let them go yesterday. Have a little surprise for you. We created all the tools yesterday and loaded them before we picked you up this morning, all ready to go.
Well, I'm elated, Bernie. The specimens are still unpacked.
Oh, yes, of course. We've got them tagged, but I thought you'd want to see them first.
Who's that by the truck? That isn't Randall.
No, that's Henderson, Pug Henderson. He was foreman of the work gang. Now, that's his truck. We kept him on to help with the loading.
Get Randall. Henderson! Good Lord!
Must have been Randall.
Paul, get a tarp and cover this poor fellow.
Yes, sir. Where's Randall?
Randall? This tent hasn't been struck. It's been torn down. It looks like a tornado's come through here.
Randall!
Randall!
From Mother Moore!
There's someone over there.
Henry Harvey had another role at Channel 3 besides being a villain in this film. During the day, he was a children's cartoon host by the name of Freddie Fodd, who hosted cartoons every day from his treehouse. Yes, an odd little bit there, but, well, many kids like, well, me, watched Freddie Fodd when we were kids.
And now back to the Basement Sublet of Horror.
The exteriors for the film, which was supposed to be in the Southwest, were actually right outside of Wichita, which isn't the Southwest, at a lake called Lake Afton, which is famous for its, well, boys' academy, you'd say, or boys' prison. But anyway, out by the lake.
Well, at that time, Bill Sykes had moved over as program director for KSN, and he and I, well, we've been friends for a long time. So we were kicking around and said, well, Bill, why don't we do, hey, let's do Nightmare. We had a film package then. We were running on Saturday nights. No Saturday Night Live, of course. And there were some films in it, you know, that we could lift out. So he thought it'd be a kick. So it just so happened we had a cameraman by the name of Jim Herring who wanted to act and did a tremendous job, as you well know, just really great as Rodney. And they were about the same proportion as Lee was, you know, big man, muscular guy. And so we kicked it off. Wild man? I don't know, but he was a wild man. Could be me. What you saw is what you get, said with Jim, because he was a wild guy. Real a nice guy. Real wild, though. Crazy guy.
Jim Herring was not much given to interviews, so poor quality as it is, we treasure this telephone interview recorded in April 85, shortly after he had won his third Emmy for his camera work for NBC and just before his death from a heart attack at the tragically early age of 39.
There was a thing where I got started working at the station doing camera, and Tom was doing the kid show there, Major Astro, and he just brought up the fact that he was wanting to bring the show back. I'd always wanted to get into acting, and we'd become pretty good friends, so we started doing the show, and we had a lot of fun. When I was a kid, Nightmare was on the air at KTV when he worked there. And I used to watch it at that time, and a guy by the name of Lee Parsons played Rodney. Tom is a real professional and a real talented man who is very good at writing, and he's written a lot of magazine articles and a lot of different things over the years. Tom saved everything. Basically, what he did was he took the old scripts that he had from the back in the days he was at KTV and just updated them. And Tom designed the set, and he had the set built. And I actually helped build the set in the basement. Gerald Smith, who was the floor manager and one of the cameramen down there, he was the one that did most of the building on it. And Tom painted it, and then Dick and I lit the show. So it was a kind of a thing that was real strange. We would work during the daytime and do our regular hours, and then on, I'm not even sure what night we actually taped the show on, but I would work on an 8-hour day, and before I would go home, we'd set the Nightmare set up. And I would light it, or Dick would light it, the way that it was supposed to be lit. And then I would go home and eat dinner, and come back, and go through about 2 hours of makeup with Tom in the women's restroom at Car TV. It was the only place that had a mirror we could sit down there. Tom basically told me how to put the makeup on. And then I did my own makeup every week as he did his own makeup because it was too tedious of a job to have, you know, one guy do all of it because it took so much time to do. So we just basically learned how to put our own makeup and we both did it ourselves. It took us a while to get it on because of the type of makeup that we used and the nose putty and the stuff that we had to do. So it would have been pretty difficult for one guy to do it both, so we both had to do our own stuff. The show that we did, which was a wallpapering show, which out of all the shows that we did over the 2 years or so that we were on the air, was really basically a nothing show, but it just happens to be the only one that we have on tape. I was more of a comedy buff. When I went into that Rodney character, I took a lot of comedy things from W.C. Fields and things that I wanted to incorporate into whatever we were doing as far as, of course, at that time was very new to the business and didn't really know anything about acting or comedy or anything else, but I just tried to do what I could do to make the character funny the way I felt it was supposed to be. I wasn't supposed to be a scary character. I was supposed to be a funny buffoon.
It lasted about 1971, so when did this start? In 69, I guess, wasn't it? So it lasted about 3 years. Jim went to the West Coast to, you know, try to get into television out there as a cameraman, which he did. Became an NBC sports cameraman. You know, with the shoulder cam, the mini cam thing. Did the golf tournament with football and all that, yes. And then my contract terminated with KSN, and that was it. And after he'd gone, we didn't bother to do it, of course. I didn't want to find a new Rodney anyway. We got real good ratings on KSN. Cake, it wasn't sophisticated. In those days, it wasn't as sophisticated, you know. I mean, like it is now. I mean, you have a... How many do you deliver with people with three moles on their face now, you know? But back in those days, but we got tremendous demographics at KSN. It was like 33%, 11 to 18, 33% of the viewing audience was 18 to 35, and then 33% was from 35 on up, you know? Really good demographics, tremendous demographics. Of course, your total households are down at that time of night anyway. Viewers, sets in use are way down. But we dominated it. I mean, Cake and 12 were running movies, and the total of their two metro points didn't equal ours at that time. I had two. One was the trip to the moon. The other one was the making a monster, where we made the monster. And decided we despaired of all the latex, phony-looking creatures that we see in the movies, so we were going to make a genuine monster, Rodney and I, and then go through all the rigmarole, and we finally wind up, and we have the operating table out there, and the cloth over it, and the two poles sticking up with the, what do you call them, where the electricity jumps between them, had them up there, and we were in doctor smocks and masks. I had a mask on my face, he did too, but it was over his eyes, and it made him straighten. Anyway, we go through all the rigmarole and throw the switch, and we were going to do all the surgery before we throw the switch. And we had a Texaco roadmap, and that's how we were going out. We were connecting the main arteries and from his Tucum Carry down to his El Paso and things like that, this Texaco roadmap. Then we threw the switch, and the electricity went like this, you know. And he's supposed to come to life, and threw back the thing over him, and here are two hamburgers and an order of French fries sitting there. Smoking, and I just am disgusted that that's all we came out with, and Rodney starts smelling it and starts eating it. Of course, I'm horrified when he eats it, destroying our offspring like that, cannibalism. But the final shot was I decided to partake of a little extremity here and picked up a French fry, and that was a fade-out, you know. I'm having a good time. That was a fun one to do. Had a good ending. Of course, the landing on the moon where we took on our rocket ship and crashed through a house, roof of a house, and we were supposed to go into the moon, landed in a bedroom, and we see ourselves in the mirror of a dresser, and we think they're moon people, and I'm trying to communicate with them, like, you know, how we have come over the great void, you like they did in the Western. It is kind of a kick. Oh, just two I had published, two short stories I had published in IF magazine, science fiction magazine, one called One Martian Afternoon, the other called The Tape Jockey. Oh, that's ancient history. That goes way back to about 51, 52, somewhere along there. One Martian Afternoon was, I was under the influence of Ray Bradbury at that time, so it's very Bradbury-like, you know. I don't know whether I want to go through that again. You know, I've got a whole bunch of scripts. I've got about 52 scripts that I've kept. And I'm not really a guy to keep memorabilia, but I don't know why I kept them, but I kept them. Just, I guess, to get them out once in a while, read them or something. It's hard to say. It's really hard to say. If they wanted to, I suppose, we would have search for Rodney or something like that and maybe have it on.
But we didn't realize back then what a remarkable thing the Leahy intros were. And so what you're about to see is the only surviving intact nightmare intro with Tom Leahy as the host and Lee Parsons as Rodney from near as we can figure out, 1959. If any of you have any Leahy material, we'd sure like to hear from you.
Good evening. The persistent monsoon that moans in the night, its breath a searing flame from the bowels of the underworld, carries on its breast an urgent plea from the quintillions of lost souls that roam the shadow world of that dark dimension. And this message vibrates serpentine like up a royal across desolate wastelands through the oily waters of the amphibian infested swamps over the crest of the ice capped peaks and down to the blasted hearth to shriek in our attentive audio receptacles that the hour for nightmare is once again at hand. And what a succulent morsel
a good fortune that we were ever at the ready for such a thing, video thieves. For a real blood-icer, bone-brittler of a cinema is about to flicker to life on your television screens. It is called The Frozen Ghost. And guess who stars in it? Boris? No. Baylor? No. But I'll give you a little hint. If a thing is frozen, it is bound to be stiff. Now, who is the stiffest actor in the universe? Huh? Right! Lon Chaney Jr., the most horrible horror thespian ever to don grease paint of unearthly hue and plastics of a natural born. By the warlocks of Waxahachie, what are you doing, Rodney? You rude roustabout! Rodney, turn that blasted thing down! You hear me? What is this? Rodney, have you capitulated to the adolescent philosophy of rebellion without cause? Have you? Well, it serves you well enough, Rodney. You're getting so flaccid, show-offish about everything. Huh. Now, you just plop your young flanks down on that chair a minute, fresh sprig. It's time you and I had a monster-to-monster talk. Straight from the shoulder, so to speak. Anatomically, that is. Huh. Well, let me confide in you, good girl. Has ever a bond of amigoship ever known such continual assault and strain wrought by this callow clod's vacillating taste? Oh, it is indeed a caution, and it requires the most assiduous of direction to lead him from these extremist tangents. Well, while I map my campaign, you troops bivouac by your TV sets to perceive the first act of The Frozen Ghost.
Well, that's it, folks. Thanks for watching, and thanks to Tom Leahy for some golden memories. And keep your eye on this space. We just may be back someday to remember Major Astro.
Go on, Wave 99.
To be suffering from shock. We've got to get him to a doctor right away.
Creighton,
come on.
Creighton, come with us.
Get away from me.
Don't come near me. It's gotta be buried, you hear me?
Murray, you blind fool, you should have known.
Shut up and listen.
You saw Henderson, didn't you?
That's what it can do, Murray. That's what it can do.
What does he mean, Ed?
Randall, did you kill Henderson?
No, you idiot. Didn't you hear me?
Get this. We never should have taken it from the earth, Maury. It's against nature. We've got to bury it again, Maury. God, we don't. It'll kill us all. We've got to bury it, Maury. Bury it deep.
What's he talking about?
Randall, listen to me.
Randall,
what did you do with the corpse?
Maury, don't you understand? It's got to be buried. It did it.
You think I'm crazy, don't you?
You've got to believe me, Maury. It's got to be buried.
Where is the body?
Over there, where he fell.
Is that what Randall was talking about?
Yes.
Good Lord, Bernie, it looks like a...
Now, go ahead, say it, you'd be right. It's the body of a prehistoric man. And fantastic as it seems, we took it from the same strata as the repto bone.
He's not dead now.
And we've got to get it back on the ground, do you hear?
We will, Randall, we will. But you need medical attention.
No, it's got to be buried!
I promise you, Randall, we will bury it. Maury and I will bury it for you, I promise. Now, will you go to town with Paul, please?
Good. And Paul, get in touch with the sheriff as soon as you get to town.
All right. Come on, Creighton. They'll take care of it. Come on.
You said you removed this corpse from the same deposit as the dinosaur fossils, Maury. Are you suggesting that this body is that old?
I'm not suggesting anything, Doctor. I'm stating a fact. Now, look here. You see that ruptured flesh on the cranium?
Yeah.
The charred area? Well, Randall and I ran carbon-14 tests on a bit of it. The atomic disintegration indicates its age in excess of several million years.
Impossible.
Improbable. Not impossible, Doctor.
Could there have been a malfunction in the scintillometer?
No. We checked it thoroughly. And look here, Doctor. He's a comparatively advanced representative of human evolution. You have noticed the location of where the spine joins the skull. The pronounced evidence of a chin.
Near Neanderthal type.
Yes, that's what I thought.
But why? Why is the corpse in such an amazingly excellent state of preservation? Anything that ancient should be a mass of broken, petrified bones. And if not that, at least mummified.
Why, these muscles are supple. Its skin is spongy, almost like living tissue.
Yeah, there must have been some chemical properties of the shale that... Well, that's odd.
Yes, most odd.
No, I mean, when we discovered this body yesterday, the limbs were rigid. Those muscles were all constricted. But now they're completely relaxed.
You found it yesterday? Well, undoubtedly, the body is starting to deteriorate. We should get it into some sort of refrigeration as soon as possible.
Yes, by all means.
It hasn't lain down here since yesterday, has it?
Of course not. We took it to the tent just as soon as we had it free from the rock strata. Matter of fact, we spent the better part of last night removing the shale from around it. No, Randall must have dragged it down here after he went berserk and killed Henderson.
If he killed Henderson. We'd better get it out of the sun. Give me a hand and we'll put it in the back of the station wagon.
One of the most bizarre crime stories in Las Mesas County history reached a climax today when a jury of 8 men and 4 women found scientist Creighton Randall guilty of murder in the first degree. Randall had been accused of the shovel slaying of Cletus Henderson, local labor contractor who had been employed by a field party of the Parnfield Museum of Natural History. Randall was a member of that party. The grisly murder followed the momentous discovery of the completely intact body of a prehistoric man.
Well, according to that psychiatrist that the board appointed, this Randall fella showed a... Now, let's see. What did he call it? A pronounced psychopathic personality. Yeah, that's it. A psychopathic personality.
Then you believe that Randall actually did kill Henderson, Sheriff?
Oh, there ain't no doubt of it, Doctor. Used that sharpshooter on him.
At times, he seems most rational. When he is, he keeps insisting that that body they discovered came to life to kill Henderson.
Yes, and he becomes almost panicky when he senses we didn't rebury it.
Now, I don't know much about this, but in that psychiatrist's testimony, he said it was typical. Having an imaginary person guilty of a crime that he committed. Now, it seems to me that Randall had his tailor-made in this thing you dug up.
The board recommended that he be committed to a state institution for the criminally insane. Will that be here?
No, sir. I think arrangements are being made to send him back near his home.
Good, good. You have our address, Sheriff, if you need us again.
Yep, but I don't think we will. Say, where's that other feller, Maury?
He's at the freight office making arrangements for the shipment of our specimens. However, we are going to fly the prehistoric body to the museum. Can't afford to waste time.
Let me ask you something, Doctor. It ain't none of my business, but is this body you dug up that all-fired important?
Well, the mere fact that the flesh is so well preserved is remarkable in itself. But if its age is confirmed as being contemporary with the dinosaurs, it'll be a most momentous discovery. By the way, Sheriff, I'd like to thank you for clearing our crates for shipment so quickly. We appreciate that.
Why, there wasn't no need holding them. Say, that caveman. You know, that doggone thing looked as much like a monkey as it did a man.
Sheriff, you come to Arnfield sometime, and I'll show you some reconstructions that make this fellow look ultra-modern by comparison.
Uh-uh. That one's enough for this old boy.
Sheriff, I wonder if I could speak with Randall before we leave.
Well, I don't know. He ain't making much sense.
We were very close friends.
Well, I guess it's all right. He's in room 302. So, you just give this to the guard outside his door there, and he'll let you in. But listen, if that feller gets violent, you yell for him. You understand? I shouldn't be letting you do this in the first place.
Well, thank you, Sheriff.
It's quite all right.
I think everything will be all right.
I hope you'll be all right.
Sure you will, too.
You've been most cooperative, Sheriff. Thank you very much.
Glad to be able to help you fellas, Doctor. Come back.
I'll meet you at the car in about 10 minutes, Doctor.
Fine, Paul.
I'll be right outside if you need me.
I'll knock.
Craig. It's Paul.
They buried it yet?
Yes. Yes, it's buried.
Thank God. It could kill again.
Look, Creighton, can you tell me more about this thing killing Henderson?
Why? You don't believe me, do you?
Of course I believe you.
Watch Maury.
Maury?
You don't know about Maury. Nobody does. But I do.
Yes. Yes, I will. Now, tell me how that corpse could have killed Henderson.
The lightning. It's got to be buried before it storms again. It fades on the lightning. It gets its life. Please, Paul, bury it.
It is buried.
No. Let it get Maury first. That despicable vermin. Let him steal it like he planned to do. Then let it get Maury like it got Henderson. Paul, it was awful. Paul.
We'll take care of it.
Down here, Paul.
I thought you were in the car.
Oh, my curiosity got the best of me. Tell me, do you believe there's more to this story than we know?
No, I suppose not. But I'm not sold on that psychiatrist's conclusions. I find it hard to believe that Randall was capable of committing such an atrocious crime, no matter what his mental state.
Well, who then? You certainly don't think that body came to life and did it.
At this stage, I just don't know, Doctor.
Could Maury have done it before he came to pick us up?
No. The time of death set by the coroner eliminates that possibility. It's just that, well, at the time we found Randall, he seemed more hysterical than insane. Though he'd just been confronted with some indescribable horror.
Is he more rational now?
No, not really. One thing for certain, though, he despises Maury. Implied he was planning to steal the body.
Good heavens, what for? To start his own museum?
As I said, he wasn't rational.
George, I just can't get over your finding this, what do you call this thing?
Oh, we haven't even taken time to think about a name for it yet. Newspaper boys have come up with some colorful ones, though. What was that one in this morning's paper, Elise?
Let's see. Sorry a man makes monkey out of evolution.
Did you see tonight's? Which came first, the monkey or the man?
Ouch! That should make some of your colleagues bristle, John.
You think it hasn't already? Why, no less than 10 of our leading paleontologists have demanded that I prove its age.
You are certain, aren't you?
Have you no faith in us, Ford?
Well, yes, but I...
Well, put your mind at ease. We are sure. Maury and Benson and I have been burning the midnight oil for the past 3 weeks just to be certain. And every possible test has pointed to one hard fact. That body is definitely many millions of years old.
Now, how do you explain a man who should have lived how many years ago?
50, 60,000.
Yes, how do you explain his being contemporary with the dinosaurs?
Now, that's the question we were afraid you'd ask.
We don't explain it. How could we?
Why don't you all continue this discussion in the living room while Grace and I clear the table?
What confounds me, if that body is so blasted old, how come it's so well preserved?
Oh, perhaps a fortunate combination of chemicals in the swamp into which it had fallen may account for it. However, Bernie has a more imaginative theory.
What's that?
Bernie?
Well, I agree in part with Dr. Crawford.
That's generous.
Ford. Go ahead, Bernie.
As I said, I agree in part. But the chemicals would have done little more than mummify the body. No, something else was needed to preserve it in the state in which we found it. Now, we know that he'd been struck by lightning, electrocuted. So I hypothesized that this severe jolt of electricity had halted the bodily processes, causing them to immediately cease to function as living matter, and arresting all cellular deterioration as well.
Holding them static, isn't that correct, Bernie?
Yes, static.
You believe this thing exists in a state of suspended animation?
In a sense, yes.
And that it actually isn't dead?
Not in the conventional sense of the word, no.
Nonsense. Utter nonsense.
Don't label it nonsense, Ford. We have to consider any theory that has a basis in fact.
Confound it, John. Are you letting this oddball rub off on you?
You insufferable boor. By what right do you pass judgment on me?
Bernie, stop it. You keep out of this, Crawford.
You are through with this museum, Maury, and by heaven, I'll make sure you never find a place in any other.
Cool down, both of you. Now, Bernie, I'm sure that Ford didn't mean what he said in the way you took it.
I'll be hanged if I didn't. The confounded man's been a misfit ever since he joined us.
Well, that's the situation. I intend to rectify at once. I'm sorry it turned out this way, Dr. Crawford.
Don't be hasty, Bernie. We'll talk about this in the morning.
No, I'm going by the museum and pick up my effects tonight.
What's all the disturbance?
Congratulations, Ford. You were most diplomatic.
Did you expect me to sit there and take his insults?
I expected you to keep an open mind to any sincerely advanced theory, whether you thought he was wrong or not. Maury's had an exhausting 3 months of work, Ford, and to my way of thinking, he had far more legitimate excuse for his irritability than you.
Well, how could you expect any rational person to sit there without saying a word while some lunatic spins a cockeyed yarn about that thing being buried, neither dead nor alive, for 60 million years?
Could you prove it otherwise? Now, be honest, Ford. Had I advanced that theory, your reaction to it would have been far different, wouldn't it?
Well, I... Yes, I suppose so. Oh, all right. I'll make it a point to apologize to the to the fellow in the morning.
I'm afraid that'll be too late. I think we should follow him to the museum tonight.
No, you go. I'll see him in the morning. I just couldn't right now, John. Let me cool down a little.
As you wish. Shall we go, Paul?
Certainly.
Yes, well, I'll be running along. I'll see him first thing in the morning. Oh, Elise, thank you for your hospitality. The dinner was delicious.
Our pleasure, Mr. Boyson.
John, sorry about the, Well, good night.
What in the world happened?
Mr. Barson and Maury crossed swords. We'd better go too, Paul. We want to catch him before he leaves the museum. I'll go out and bring the car around.
All right, I'll be right out, Doctor. Good night, darling.
Aren't you coming back with John for a nightcap?
You'd rather I would?
Yes. These past few weeks have been so horrible for all of us. I'd like to spend just a little time like we used to sit and talk. It seems there hasn't been a word exchanged between any of us unless it pertained to that dreadful corpse of poor Creighton.
You're right, Elise. I'll be right back. There's John now. I'll see you later.
Besides directing and
Besides writing and directing this film and actually starring as the creature, Tom Leahy, the man of many talents, who was also, as I mentioned earlier, the host in Rodney, had another role on Wichita TV. During the day, he was a children's cartoon host who went by the name of Major Astro. He'd appear every day and his ship would land and he would come in with a spacesuit on and host cartoons. Yeah, quite a bit of nostalgia there for you.
Affirmative. We read and copy. All systems are go for telecast in T-minus 7 seconds. This is Mission Control, KSAS Earth Space Complex, standing by and monitoring.
Hi, boys and girls. I'm Major Astro, and say, listen, on this 30th day of September, it's time to announce our birthday cake winner for today, and it is Jim Hill of Hutchinson, Kansas. Jim, I hope this is a great day for you. Major Astro is going to send you a letter in the mail congratulating you, and the next time you and your parents come down to Wichita, bring it with you, take it to either one of the Cameo Cake locations, give it to them, and they are going to give you a delicious birthday cake. So once again, a happy birthday to Jim Hill of Hutchinson.
Now, you'll be with me tomorrow on the program, won't you, for sure? I certainly hope so, because then everything is going to be A-OK, and all systems will be go. Happy orbits, boys and girls. I'll see you then. Mission Control, this is Major Astro, returning all systems to Earth Control.
And now back to the Basement Sublet of Horror.
It is I, the host, you hyperventilating hyphens, to arrest the progress of this dud of a demonic drama, so we can pay for the thing.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Tom Leahy. I am the resident transient down here at the Kansas State Network. And before we see the movie tonight, I've rounded up the remaining members of the cast of that classic movie, The Beast from the Beginning of Time, which I'm sure you've seen promoted on the Kansas State Network. I'd like to introduce them to you at this time. First, I want to do this in kind of a novel way. I want to take them as they were in the movie, and then we're going to show them as they are now. I'm not going to show myself. All right, here's the first one. This is Chuck Neisler, and Chuck was is the head of an advertising agency. The name of the advertising agency is
Neisler Advertising.
Oh, that's a very good name. Hey, that was quick thinking.
Wow.
Do you want to see yourself 16 years ago? As you looked in the movie, all right, director, there is Chuck. Now, I like that posture you've got there. What do you have in your hand?
To tell you the truth, I don't remember if that was a sawed-off shotgun or a rifle.
I think it was. We shot that out at Lake Acton, as I recall.
Yes. What was it, a rifle or a shotgun?
I think you had a shotgun because you blew me away.
That comes later.
Well, as I told you, ladies and gentlemen, this is 16 years ago that we made this movie, in 1965. The Kansas State Network did it, and I guess they were soused or something. Anyway, they said, go ahead, make a movie. Why not? Another gentleman that we had in it, one of the nicest guys I know, and you see him every night on the KSN News at 10 o'clock, is Mr. Webb Smith. We picked him to play a villain in this thing. See what a benign aspect this gentleman has. Now let's take a look at Webb in a typical a typical mood he was in the picture. And, Webb, what do you think of that? Well, you still have that hat?
The hat's gone, but I was a heavy and I loved it.
Yeah.
Every second of it.
That shows my perverse nature because I picked all the nice guys to play heavies in this thing. And the next two guys are heavies in it, too. This gentleman on my right, that is my right, I got the rock in the hand here, is Dr. Welsbacher, Richard Welsbacher, the head of the drama department at Wichita State University. Right?
University Theater, that's right.
Yeah.
And you gathered up the remains, I heard you say that.
Well, we've been old friends for a long time. Now, I want to show you how Dick, and I want you to look at this, Dick, and see what you look like a long time ago. You've reversed the process. You've got more hair than you had then.
Than I had then, that's right.
Yeah.
That's my younger brother.
Yeah, that's your younger brother. You're talking to the late John Froom in this particular scene.
That's right.
A man we all remember, and we'll talk about him a little bit later. Now, the other gentleman that we have with us this morning is Mr. Henry Harvey. And Henry, at the present time, is associated with Channel 12. Glad to have you with us, Henry.
Thank you, Tom. Good to be here.
Yeah, and Henry is known to everyone here in the market, one of the pioneers. Can I call you a pioneer?
If you want to.
Well, we're
one of the real heavies.
Yeah, no, but a pioneer in television and did the Freddie Fudd show and various other things.
Oh, yeah.
That a real tremendous talent. Now, I'll show you Henry. Now, he doesn't have to gray his hair now, but we used to have to gray his hair when we shot the
film.
Really? Did we take a look here?
Right,
Henry. What's that in your hand?
I don't believe that.
What is that? That's Gatorade.
I had a double chin there.
Yes, you did. You were fatter in those days.
And I was sort of bald.
But anyway, I want to ask these guys one thing. I want to ask, and I'll start with Neisler. Neisler, what was the most memorable moment in that filming, that ordeal we went through when we shot this thing? To you?
The most memorable moment to me was the paycheck that I received.
You got one.
Well, you know actors make big money. So yes, that's the way it goes. The paycheck. How about you, Webster Shale?
I think the most memorable moment I remember, of course, when we were out on location doing the bed along a creek out west of Lake Afton.
102.
102, mm-hmm. There was a great supply of beer. And I was acting as the grip. I was carrying beer to those who needed, including the photographer, the cameraman, and
Mr. Edison.
Edison. Shot. And then I remember after consuming quite a bit of it myself, that I finally got to my place, and I had the, well, they'll find out.
Yeah.
But I had chocolate syrup in my mouth.
That's
on top of beer.
Chocolate beer is very good. I want to tell you the most memorable thing to my way of thinking was I remember, I think the greatest moment was we got Dr. Welsbacher in a suit and a tie in the thing. Actually, you'll see Dick's casual, like all of us, and I wish you'd get a shot of his moccasins. You got them on today, too.
Oh, yeah,
you?
I got them on today.
Great. But anyway, now, let me ask you, Richard, which was your most memorable moment?
Well, Webb mentioned chocolate syrup. I suppose the most memorable moment was the one where I was stuffed upside down in a closet for about 45 minutes or so while they got the shot with chocolate syrup all over my shirt and arm. And it was about 112 in there, too, I think. And another thing I remember, though, got to be kind of a local gag, was I could always tell, I would always say, it's spring now officially because Tom Leahy just called and said, let's make a horror movie.
Yeah, that did happen right off. I should have said a horrible movie.
A horrible movie.
All right, Henry. What about you now?
I think the most memorable moment was when 3 hours later he found out he was in the closet. No, I think my most memorable moment was when I found out I had been misinformed and I should have memorized my lines.
Yes, you made cheat sheets.
Yeah, in a hurry.
Yeah. Oh, well, we had a great time doing it, and I hope you enjoy it. It's a Dick Welsbacher shudders every time he sees the film. But anyway, I think you'll like it. And I want to thank you guys for being here with me this evening.
Listen, we haven't had a chance to thank you.
For what?
For the fun that everybody
had. Well, we did have a good time. It was a lot of fun. It actually was. I wouldn't want to do it again, but it was a lot of fun.
Probably the most unrecognized creative mind ever hit the city of Wichita and this business is Tom Leahy.
Absolutely. Oh,
tremendously talented fellow.
Shucks.
Fantastic talented
fellow. Tom,
I really wouldn't mind doing it again.
You interrupted
me. See, I did that without the cheat sheet.
All right, thank you so much, guys. And I tell you, now I got to do a little metamorphosis right now, if you don't mind. So I'm going to metamorph right before your very eyes.
Good evening. Those perpetuous palpitations that pulsate through the cosmos have once again wafted with urgent urgency our psychic cross to this foreboding clime.
Good goose. What a bully bash we're going to experience. For tonight, before your very optic orbs, you are going to perceive the television debut of the beast from the beginning of time. A monumental motion picture that the producers say has spent 16 years in the can. Well, anyone who wants to spend 16 years that long in the can is beyond my comprehension. Nevertheless, there it has been. And now at long last, as we say in the shoemaking biz, it is about to grace the silver rectangle of your video audio receivers. That babbling baboon, Rodney, has gone over to his Uncle Grubbs for a little Halloween party. You know, pinning the tail on the dinosaur, bobbing for piranhas, all that fun jazz. But he will join us later for a few delectable moments.
But now, away with you to the first act of The Beast from the Beginning of Time.
Hold your horses, I'm coming. Who's there?
Bernard Murray, open up.
All right, come, you got caught out in the rain tonight, didn't you, Professor?
Yes, I did. It's a regular downpour.
Gonna do a little night work tonight?
Yes, Charlie.
Well, the lights are all off down there. You want me to come with you and turn them on for you?
No, I can manage.
Well, if you need old Charlie, I'll be down in the furnace room. Just holler. By gum, a strange fella, that fella.
You have 24-hour service. Well, all right, then. I need a truck at once. What? 2 hours? Why 2 hours? Oh, damn the storm. What? Well, when? Now, look, I'll give you double the usual charge. What? Hello? Hello? Dead.
Charlie? Is that you, Charlie? Dr. Crawford? Paul? Well, speak up, man. What is... Oh, no!
Find it credible, Doctor?
Well, the flesh hadn't deteriorated, and the intestines, the vital organs, are intact.
Then it could be.
Oh, I suppose so. Why? What do you think, Paul?
Well, this may sound crazy, but I don't think Creighton killed Henderson.
What?
I believe the corpse, the Neanderthal did.
Good Lord, how?
Well, I don't know exactly. Perhaps Randall was right.
Lightning.
He seemed terrified that a storm would break before we buried the corpse. Now, if the condition had been brought about by lightning, it could be that it's regenerated by it. What do you think? Would this be possible?
I don't know, Paul. I just don't know. Probably in his office. Call the police. Hello. Hello. It's dead.
Look, here, Doctor. Those are its footprints.
It must have dragged Maury's body through there.
What'll we do now?
Follow that trail of blood. We've got to find Maury.
Hadn't better go for the police?
No, I think we'd better try to find Maury first. Then you can go for the police.
Me? Hadn't we both better go?
No, I think one of us should stay here and try to keep that thing in the building. The service door is the only one that's unlocked, isn't it, Paul?
Yes, as far as I know. But, Doctor, one of us is no match for that thing.
This gun is our equalizer, Paul. Let's lock the service door, then pick up that blood trail. I'm sure it'll lead us to Maury. Pray God he's dead. We'd better not separate till then. This beast kills like a wild animal, but it is human. And as such, it'll have a certain degree of predatory intelligence.
Thank you.
lights are gone. Is Charlie's flashlight working?
Looks all right here, Doctor.
That should do. Let's pick up the trail again.
From the looks of this, boy doesn't stand a prayer. Doctor. Oh, Maury. God, Maury. Lock the door, Paul. We don't want this beast getting at Maury's body again.
You thought the possibility might be carnivorous?
Yes, and we'd better recover Charlie's body and lock it in my office until we can contact the police. Let's go. He's gone. It's already taken him. Come on.
There.
The pistol's loaded. Let's go.
There it is.
Those bullets didn't even faze him, Doctor. I could see the slug tearing into his body.
The sound of the gun seemed to frighten him. Let's go for the police.
Rain stopped.
When I was a wee lad, back in England, I'm from Wichita. Anyway, in Wichita, we lived next door to Ralph Seeley. And so when he was working on this film and other films, I used to go over to their house and watch him build the effects. Yes, he built the effects for these movies. And I saw him build the effects for their next film, which is called Green Hell from the Void, I believe, anyway. And I watched him build, there was a UFO flying saucer he built out of wood, and he built a spindle, and he did a test where he ran it on a wire across the garage, and he covered it with sawdust, this wooden UFO shape, and then gasoline and set it on fire in his garage. It was quite exciting. And then he also made a shovel that they cut off, and so when it would appear that it was someone got killed by getting stabbed in the stomach with a shovel, and the shovel's cut off, you know, like, and it looks like if you pull away and reverse the camera film, it looks like you're stabbing someone. I don't know, it's effect stuff. Read up on that stuff. You'll understand what I'm talking about. Anyway, well, Ralph Seeley, he was a pretty cool guy, and he's no longer around, I'm sorry to say, but I really would like to thank him indirectly for kind of taking me under his wing and showing me how he worked on these films when I was a kid. It was really quite a fun experience for me then. Thank you, Ralph.
And now, back to the Basement Sublet of Horror.
Retard your exuberance, you roisterous rhinos, for it is foot the bill time again. Proceed.
As I mentioned earlier, Tom Leahy, the director, also starred on local TV in Wichita as the host in the show The Host and Rodney, as I mentioned before. And so I thought I'd take a few minutes now to show you some excerpts from some rare film that we've just found from the early show. This is from the 50s. This is Tom Leahy as the host, and I believe Lee Parsons as Rodney. Here we go.
I suspected that your
morbid curiosity would lure you back to hear the tale we have for you tonight. No, it is a charming one, too, fraught with sentiment and nostalgia. It's the story of the mummy. Ah! Now, all you mother's boys out there, quit clapping and giggling so. It's not that kind of mummy. No, this is the story of a well-preserved young man who kept his love for an Egyptian princess under wraps for 3,700 years. And it had him all tied up in knots. Rodney. Rodney! Where is that frolicsome boy? Rodney! Rodney! Don't startle me like that. You know how sensitive I am. I'll have good dreams all night long. Now go back there and get the book of our subscribers and bring it down here to me. He's a good boy. Wait a minute, I have something for you. There. Take Fred over in the corner and crouch. As you know, a money-pursuing but benevolent group of people are responsible for our little rendezvous. And now, those of you with strong nerves, and those of you who just don't care, pull up your chairs real close so you can see every single wrinkle on the countenance of Freud's caller as the mummy.
In 2001, a bunch of Tom Leahy's fellow broadcasters and friends and Killian Enterprises gathered together to stage a roast of Tom Leahy. And they had an evening event. And also, I believe at that time, they inducted him into the Kansas Broadcasters Hall of Fame. So here's the program cover. Anyway, they had a whole program. And I guess it was quite an event. And I really regret not attending the event. I hear it was a really special evening. So I'd like to thank Killian Enterprises and Tom Leahy's friends for doing that for him. That was a really nice thing. And also for inducting him into the Kansas Broadcasters Hall of Fame. Tom Leahy's a man deserving of such tributes. Basement Sublet of Horror. For a special showing of the film in 2004, they used Tom Leahy. He actually had done a painting for the film, for the poster for the film, so they reproduced it for a poster that was issued for that evening only for 2004. Let's take a look at the poster now. This is a painting by Tom Leahy, and actually online you might see there's another artwork for the film. Let's look at that now. This artwork was actually produced by the Basement Sublet of Horror just for fun. So if you see this artwork, I mean, we're flattered that people are using this around the web, but this isn't really an official poster. It's just something we produced, you know, to show along with our movie here on Basement Sublet of Horror.
Oh, meet our next team of challengers. What is your name, please?
My name is Lee Parsons.
What is your name, please?
My name is Lee Parsons.
What is your name, please?
My name is Lee Parsons.
All right, panel, will you follow along with your copies of this next affidavit?
I, Lee Parsons, am a former band singer turned television stage manager and performer. I appear every week on a program called Nightmare, which is devoted entirely to the showing of horror movies. Dressed as I am now, I help introduce such outstanding film attractions as Dracula, Son of Dracula, Frankenstein, Son of Frankenstein, The House of Frankenstein, The House of Dracula, Dracula's Daughter, Bride of Frankenstein, The Wolfman, Frankenstein Meets the Wolfman, and The Mad Ghoul, signed Lee Parsons. All right, panel, we now have three tasty little characters, all claiming to be Lee Parsons, MC of a television horror show. And let's begin a cross-examination, this time with Betty White. Betty?
Thanks a heap, buddy. Number two. How long have you had this problem? Number two, who played Dr. Frankenstein in the original Frankenstein?
The doctor?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Number one?
Colin Clive.
Number three... Did you ever see The Invisible Man?
Yes, I did.
Obviously, she's lying. Number one, what happened to the monster in the original Frankenstein at the end of the picture?
I think there was a... I don't know if that's the one where he fell into this well thing or was burnt in a windmill sort of tower structure.
Number three, who played the Bride of Frankenstein?
Elsa Lanchester.
Number one, who starred in The Wolfman?
Mr. Bela Lugosi, Claude Rains, and a newcomer called Ralph Bellamy.
Really? Number...
Watch out for his fang.
I want
All right, Wolfman?
All right, well, let's see, who else was in the cast of The Wolfman? Someone who's playing on Broadway today, put it that way. Number one, yes.
Patrick Knowles was in it.
Number two, would you know someone who's playing on Broadway today who was in the, rather prominently, in The Wolfman?
In The Wolfman?
Yes. All right, number three, would you know?
Ralph Bellamy.
Who?
Ralph Bellamy.
You not only played one of the leads, but you supported yourself.
Oh, no. Well, let me ask you then. Well, number one, what studio made, I think, all of these pictures, as I recall?
Universal made most of them.
All right. Number two, who was the leading lady in Frankenstein Meets the Wolfman, or whichever way it was?
The actor who played it?
The leading lady.
Leading lady, the actress.
I don't know.
Number...
Kitty Carlisle.
Number one, what station are you on?
WSIL in Carbondale, Illinois.
And number two, what station are you on?
KAKE-TV, Wichita, Kansas.
Number three, what station are you on?
WTAR, Norfolk, Virginia.
Number one, when you were a band singer, what was your favorite number?
I used to do this love of mine, mostly.
And number two, what was your favorite number?
I think all of Hoagy Carmichael's songs was very beautiful.
Tom Poston.
Miss America, number one.
All
doesn't do your hair? Just lovely. Number three, could you demonstrate a 30 seconds to go signal to a performer?
30 seconds.
Thank you. Number two, you'll have to excuse me. Did you cut yourself while shaving? While shaving a lion, that is?
Possibly.
Or shaving a wolfman or something. You're all pretty scary. I'd hate to meet you live.
Thanks.
Can you tell me, number one, what was the first question I was going to ask?
That's about it. It's time to vote again, and without consultation, would you please mark your ballot and select number one, number two, or number three. Okay, spiderweb's all marked. Who did you vote, Betty?
Well, I voted for number one, and then any reason I give is going to be highly insulting, but she really didn't know the answer. Truly, she did.
Ralph, what about your selection?
Number one. Number two didn't seem to know where his station was, temporarily anyway. And number three might not have been around long enough to have been the band singer.
Kitty, who do you think is the
real one? I voted for number one. I'm not an authority on horror pictures, but I think on the basis of the answers we got, it was number one.
And Tom Postman, your selection?
I voted for number three.
Oh,
thank goodness I'm not alone in this. But I thought that she knew some things that that Lee Parsons would have had to know, right? And she looks like she knows a lot more, too.
All right, there you are, however frightening our reasons were. That's the way we vote, and let's see now which of these three people turns out to be the real MC of a television nightmare horror show. Will the real Lee Parsons please stand up? It's a tribute to the other two, I must say, that you goofed on all of them that time. Number one, would you tell us who you really are and what you do, please?
My name is I'm Elaine, and I am with a daily television show, The Price is Right. I'm the fashion coordinator.
I think you ran a vice of the lovelorn column, surely. Number three, what about you?
My name is Julie Kalmus. I'm from Norfolk, Virginia, and I am owner and operator of a charm school.
Well, in all fairness to these three stalwarts who have been suffering through a long time in these makeups getting ready to frighten you and fool you as they did, we thought they ought to get a chance to show you and the audience how they really look when they don't have this makeup on. So, I'm Elaine. Would you please show us what you really look like? And Lee Parsons, show us your picture. And last but by no means least, Miss Kalmus. Let's see what you look like when you're running your charm school. Well, you beat the panel all the way down the line. Four incorrect votes at $250 each for a total of $1,000 from Arid. Thanks very much. Hope you had fun. And on your way out, you'll find there's a gift package of Carter's wonderful products for each of you. Good night, and good luck, and happy haunting.
Ah, yes, a current piece of trivia has popped up. It turns out Ralph Seeley's daughter, Tracy, has written a new book called My Ruby Slippers, and it's about her excursion to Kansas with her father, as, you know, her father was pursuing his career in the media arts and television. And there's a whole bit in there about him working with Tom Leahy and about their life in Kansas. So it's a pretty interesting little book called My Ruby Slippers. So there you go.
And now we take you back to the basement sublet of horror.
Well,
2012, Tom Leahy, the host, was nominated and inducted into the Horror Host Hall of Fame. And the event was held in Columbus, Ohio, as part of the Horror Hound Weekend, and also part of the Gothic Gathering. The Gothic Gathering is the annual Horror Host Convention. And I'd like to show you an excerpt now from the Horror Host Hall of Fame, Gothic Gathering, Horror Host Hall of Fame induction ceremony. This is my induction of Tom Leahy. And I've also had some other video added in here, too. I've got some actual live video from the event to show you. And then I'll go to my recorded bit. I couldn't make it to the event. You know, it's really disappointing to me that I couldn't be there. But I recorded a bit for it anyway. So let's take a look at that now.
Okay, for this next one, I need to do something a little creative. Oh, because you get good. Anyway, the host that really wanted to induct this next host, unfortunately, was not able to join us due to some personal issues. But he did videotape this next host's induction. The host is Tom Leahy, known as the host out of Kansas. Gunther Dedman recorded this for us, so, and it's really nice. I'll give you guys a chance to see this.
Ah, this is Gunther Dedman from the Basement Sublet of Horror, and I'd like to greet all of you out there at the Horror Hound Weekend. Tonight I'm quite pleased and very proud to induct one of the earliest horror hosts into the Horror Host Hall of Fame. He was simply known as the host. He was portrayed by Tom Leahy Jr., who was an actor, writer, and also producer on the show. The show was called Nightmare, or sometimes The Nightmare with Host and Rodney. It was produced out of Wichita, Kansas in the late 1950s, actually 1958 to be more precise. Nightmare was one of the first, earliest horror host programs out there, and it was based on the original Shock package. Tom Leahy was well-versed in the many roles in theater, radio, and television production. He wrote all the scripts of Nightmare.
Good evening. I suspected that your morbid curiosity would lure you back.
Tom Leahy began his career in radio in the late 40s, early 50s, and he moved on to television where he became a booth announcer. And, well, his creativity and versatility helped him move on to the front of the camera when the station received the Universal Shock Package. Tom Leahy's host was the ghoul type of horror host, and actually that's what inspired me to become a ghoul myself. He would play off his sidekick or co-host, Rodney.
Rodney! Don't startle me like that.
And Rodney was played by several people throughout the years, originally by Lee Parsons, then by Jim Herring, and later years was played by John Salem. Another role that Tom Leahy played was that of Major Astro, an afternoon cartoon host who would appear each day, you know, in his spaceship landing on a moon base where he would host cartoons such as Astro Boy. And that show also had an extended run on television from the 70s clear up to the 80s, and it was brought back again in the 90s. Tom Leahy also tried his hand at writing science fiction, and he wrote several novels. He also wrote the film The Beast from the Beginning of Time, which he also directed.
No! No, please!
Tom Leahy was inducted into the Kansas Broadcasters Hall of Fame in 2001, and unfortunately, in the year 2010, Tom Leahy passed away at the age of 87, leaving behind an impressive legacy that will be remembered by his fans for years to come. I'd personally like to thank Tom Leahy Jr. for all of the years of entertainment he gave us Kansas, both as the host and as Major Astro. It was really a wonderful experience having him around on television. It was quite an impact on my life, and as a matter of fact, it's the reason why I wanted to become a horror host myself. And so, fellow horror host and horror fans and horror hounds, please join me in inducting Tom Leahy Jr., the host from Nightmare, into the Horror Host Hall of Fame. I'd like to thank you all for coming. I'd like to thank Jason Hignight and the Horror Host Hall of Fame Selection Committee for bestowing this great honor onto Tom Leahy Jr. This is Gunther Dedman from the Basement Sublet of Horror. I wish I could have been there in person. Good night, my friends.
Thank you.
help it. Gary, please, it's getting awfully late.
Footprints?
Yes, those would be.
They lead off over the woods over here. Another patrol car?
That's your missus, some down unit. Do you think that thing's headed back to the museum?
I would imagine so, yes.
Rog, go up and tell. Wait a minute. Here he comes now. Did Dispatcher tell you what you're dealing with?
Yeah, as much as he knew.
All right, get back up on that road and take that girl back to town and hop over to the Pond Field Museum just as fast as that car will take you.
Go on to the service door. It's unlocked.
Rog, you come with me. We're going to track that thing back through the woods right now.
We'll go with you.
All right. Here. You know how to use it? Rod, give me your shotgun. Everybody ready? Let's move out.
In the building. Here comes Don. Rod, you stand guard here and blast that thing if it comes through the window again. We'll go around to the service door and meet him. See those wounds in his chest? Those are the ones I fired into him earlier.
But we've got to get Elise away from it.
I'll take care of that.
Looks like you're wrong, Doctor. finish it off.
No, wait, you'll only mutilate the body.
If he's not dying, what's wrong with him?
Well, we know the electrical storm reanimated him, Paul. Now I believe the energy he received is just about dissipated. Wait just a moment, officer, and we'll be able to take him without resistance. It is dead.
I don't understand.
Our modern weapons were useless against it, Paul. It was by a bizarre trick of nature that it could even exist in our time. And equally bizarre, it could only be destroyed by something from its own time. The dinosaur bone.
Concludes our epic production. And just when I was getting to like the kid with the long hair and the pronounced overbite. Rodney!
One small step for man.
When I was a kid, a man landed on the moon. Everybody made a big deal about it.
One giant leap for mankind.
I didn't think it was that big of a deal, because Major Astro had already been there.
Fly me to the moon.
In the 1960s and 70s, thousands of Kansas kids would rush home every day from school to watch Major Astro.
Do you really go to the moon? I said, do you see me do it? And they say, yeah. And I just drop it right then. I didn't lie. So they assumed he did.
Tom Leahy was the Major. He began the role in 1962, just as the space program was literally taking off. At the same time, KARD-TV, now KSN, needed to fill afternoon programming. And so, how about a children's show with an astronaut?
And, they debated about Major Astro, whether they call it Major Astro, because Astro lends itself to something else. Anyway, and she said, well, I know the guy that can do it. And so they called me.
Major Astro is a combination of space education and entertainment. It included Warner Brothers cartoons, half-hour features, Jet Jackson, the Thunderbird, Superman.
No, we had a good time. We had a good time doing the show because it was live every day. And, you know, but that was great. And I liked the kids. I like kids anyway. You can see by my grandchildren, I love them. And I enjoyed it.
The popularity of Major Astro was almost immediate. Leahy made personal appearances all across the state.
The fair, we go to the fair every year. That was a bit of an ordeal, though. I didn't dig that much, but put on the suit and the eyebrows and go out and do the hello boys and girls stuff. So.
The man in the spacesuit could draw a crowd. One time, the real astronaut, Alan Shepard, came to Oberlin to watch an air show. Now, he didn't want anybody to know he's going to be there. So when Shepard saw this huge crowd gathered at the local airstrip, he became furious.
He radios the turn. He said, I thought I told you not to tell anybody I was coming. Because Shepard was a little bit on the bitey side anyway, they say. And they said, oh, no, Mr. Shepard, we didn't. They're here to see Major Astro. And he said, who the blank is Major Astro?
Major Astro left the air in 1973. It was reborn for a while in the 1980s on KSAS-TV. Leahy still gets recognized as the Major.
And Jim all the time. Really? They usually said, gray-haired people say, I watched you when I was little. So thanks a lot there.
Tom Leahy will be 80 years old next fall. He likes to golf and fish and spend time with his grandchildren. This past year, he was inducted into the Kansas Broadcasters Hall of Fame. And even though he maybe really never went to the moon, somehow Major Astro took us there every day. He always made sure we got home just in time for dinner.
Well, everything will be A-OK and all systems will be go. Happy orbits, boys and girls.
What spring is like on Jupiter and Mars.
Well, most of the cast of this film have passed away, are no longer with us, including now Tom Leahy, who passed away last June of last year, I'm sorry to say, and I'll miss him. He was also, like as I said before, the host of the Wichita Horror House show Nightmare, which is the inspiration for this show. I know there's not a lot of direct resemblance, but it is an inspiration. And Tom Leahy, he will be missed. He was also Major Astro, and I stated earlier. But anyway, Tom Leahy, one of my favorite actors and favorite film directors. I just wanted to mention a little farewell to him. Goodbye, Tom Leahy. I've enjoyed your work over the years. It's meant a great deal to me. Thank you.
Somewhere out there in that unfathomable blackness of the universe, where unseen and unknown entities submit to catabolic metamorphoses, out there, a gaseous cloud, the residue of a nova, swirls with sinuous persistence, and the cataclysmic fires born of this horrendous explosion race through spatial planes, until on this night, this hour, this minute, this second, their light diminished, compacted, and paled by the distances they have traversed, burn as tiny beacons to guide our paths to this dark, shadowed, but homey, realm to perceive another chronicle of happenings most bizarre.
And there, a rare treat for you, the complete version of The Beast from the Beginning of Time, a rare film from the Wichita film history. And actually, it's never been released. It's never even been released to DVD. So it's actually a rare thing here to show it. So I appreciate Tom Leahy for allowing us to show the film. I appreciate you, too, for watching for all these years on The Basement Sublet of Horror. Good night, my friends.
Until we meet next week at the appointed hour, If you, the Capriccios of Boris Karloff in Frankenstein. Good night.